So this is your mock interview for your optional home science. Actually, tell me something, was home science one of your subjects in your graduation?
No, sir.
Then why did you take home science as an optional in civil service?
Sir, after analyzing the previous year questions and going through the syllabus, I found that, sir, home science is one of the best mark scoring subject. And secondly, the syllabus is also not as hectic as a pol science or pop. Therefore, I decided to take home science as one of my options.
फाइन तो इटा जो कहले ना अपन पॉल सेम पॉपर जो कहले तो सेटा लाइक अपन इंटी कोई परिवे कि एस सम ऑफ द अदर सब्जेक्ट्स एग्जैक्ट सब्जेक्ट को नेम करिवे ठीक है सर एस सम ऑफ द अदर सब्जेक्ट्स व्हिच आई वाज कंसीडरिंग सिटी का दर ओके बट हाउ इज दिस यू नो योर एक्सपीरियंस एंड योर नॉलेज ऑफ होम साइंस हेल्प यू इन योर एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव ड्यूटीज
Sir, home science is a subject which basically deals with family resource management. So, resource management is one of the point which an administrator requires. Then it teaches me about budget managing, time management. It deals with malnutrition and extension services. So, these are all the important topics of home science which will help me in dealing with various problems in the administrative line. So, yes, sir. These are the points which will help me in administrative lines.
Can you tell me, what is the composition, of a balanced diet? How much carbohydrates, how much fats, in that, for a general adult, for a normal adult, what will be the, what will be a nutritious meal? Suppose you are given the responsibility, of taking care of the midday meal of children, the lunch of grown-up adults in the age of let's say 30 to 40, 45, and for old people who are 70 plus. You have to give them balanced diet. So first tell me what diet will you propose for the children, for the adults and for the for the old people.
So basically, children require more protein enriched diet because their physical activity is much more as compared to a adult or a old person. So basically, their food should contains carbohydrates like rice, chapatis, protein-based foods like eggs, milk, and flesh. And yes, sir, and salads which will act as roughage and more amount of water because they do lot of physical work. So lot of sweat comes out from their body. So their body will be dehydrated only through water. So yes, they will require lot of water, protein-rich food, and carbohydrate as well as certain roughages. And person who is engaged in hard work will require huge protein and carbohydrate. And those who work in these professional lines like software lines. Their meals should be basically light meal, which will contain carbohydrate, protein, vitamins and minerals in equal amount. Not in equal amount, mean carbohydrate and protein in little huge amount as compared to vitamins and fruits and these are. And the old person, basically they have their digestive problem. So they should be provided with less protein and carbohydrate and they should be provided with liquid diet if they have digestion problem. So yes, sir. These are the balanced diet for a young child, adult, and old person.
You know what is basal metabolic rate?
Sir, basal metabolic rate is the amount of energy which is required to perform various essential activities of a body when a body is at rest, like breathing, respiration, digestion. ETC, sir. Brain functioning, ETC.
How this is basically used BMR? It is affected by what all factors? What factors affect your BMR?
Sir, BMR is affected by a lot of factors like the body mass, the genes we carry, then body mass, genes, then weight of the body. right? Surface area of the body, then pregnancy, disease suffered by the person, like in case of fever, the BMR usually goes up, and genes, the location of the place. Basically, a person living in tropical area has a BMR different from a person living in the Greenland or polar regions. So yes sir, these are basically the factors which affect the BMR of a person.
So you have studied about how nutrition can work as a therapy. If someone is like ill with some particular disease,
yes,
he also has to have restrictions on the food. Now India is being said as the diabetes capital of the world. So many people are pre-diabetic and also diabetic. So suppose you are given the task of suggesting a diet for the diabetic people. Okay, so what diet will you suggest them, and also tell me that how that what will be the combination of proteins, carbohydrates, what they should avoid, what they should take more.
So basically, India is a country which is a diabetic country, because most of the people in India are doing professional job and they give less time to exercise, and diabetes is also caused due to genetic factors. Basically, if a person is suffering from diabetes, then he should be provided with a certain chart which should contain less amount of carbohydrate, more amount of fruits and vitamins except banana, which contains sugar in huge amount. His sugar content should be decreased. He should be given more amount of water, and yes, these are basically. And he should be recommended to do physical exercise daily. So these are the basically criteria for a diabetic person. And sir, the food which I should recommend him is that he should have less amount of carbohydrate. The rice and chapatis should be reduced in his food. Sugar content in his food should be reduced. He should keep himself away from kheer and other type of sweet dishes. And fruit amount of fruit in his body should be increased. So he should be given proper fruits like apple and mango. Not mango. Mango contains huge sugar. Apple and other type of fruits, and basically banana should be avoided, because banana is a fruit which contains sugar in huge amount. So yes sir, and this is a.
So what are the fruits the diabetic people can eat?
Sir, almost every fruit except certain fruits like bananas, which contain huge amount of sugar, then watermelon, which also contains huge sugar. Basically, sir, these 2-3 types of fruits.
Okay. So, you know what is Codex Alimentarius?
Yes, sir.
What is that?
Sir, basically it's a organization which take care of fair fooding practices to consumer.
So currently which organization in India is taking care of that in India for the government of India?
Sir, I'm not able to.
There is something called FSSAI. Yes, do you know that? What is that?
Sir, it's a basically food safety organization in India. It takes care that food provided to the consumers are.
What is the full form?
Food Safety and Security Authority of India.
Standard.
Food Standard and Safety Authority of India.
Okay, fine. So, what are the reasons for prevalence of malnutrition, especially among children in certain parts of India, with giving more emphasis on Odisha, you can tell me.
Sir, malnutrition is a disease which is caused when we are not about the nutritional status, that is when over nutritional food is taken, when under nutritional food is taken, or when there is imbalance in proper nutrition, or when the body is not able to absorb the nutrition in proper amount. So malnutrition is basically caused in India due to many factors. Like one is that the people of India are not aware about the nutritional values of the foods. Second is the lack of two times meal to people. Third is their basically preference to a male child. The female child doesn't get proper nutrition in the house. Certain religious sentiments which do not allow Brahmins to eat meat or flesh, and so they lack protein yes sir, these are certain problems of causes of malnutrition. Yes sir.
Okay. Fine. So can you tell me about the various factors which we have to take into consideration when the children are growing, okay, in the age group of 0 to 5 years old?
So various
factors, okay, that you have to keep in mind. Like, you know, when the child is born till 5 years, what will be his growth and development? Okay, physical growth, mental growth, okay, psychomotor skills, okay. So those things, what care the parents have to take?
What care?
I mean, the child is small, like stage wise you can say, or you can, in a sense what I'm asking is, you explain the Paget's stages of growth.
Okay sir, Paget's stages of growth basically is divided into four stages. First one is sensory motor stage. This is the stage where the child gets control about his reflexes. That is, he gets control how to manage his body in space. Second is the pre-occupational stage. It is basically from 2 to 7 years age. Basically, this is the egocentric age where the child thinks everything in according to him. This is basically a logical thinking period. And third is the concrete occupational stage. In this stage, the child develops his thinking, and he develops his thinking, and this is basically the stage of schooling and education is given. So he develops mathematical reasoning, verbal reasoning, and various types of this mental ability. And fourth is the 12 onwards, that is when the child enters into the adolescent phase. Here there is a development of mind. He can make various types of cognitive development which earlier he was not able to do, like his vocabulary increases, his amount of speaking becomes better. And these are all the 4 to 5 stages of Paget's.
Mm-hmm. Okay. What do you mean by exceptional children, and you know, how they are classified?
So exceptional children are the children who are not normal. They are above normal personality or below normal persons, like having visual impairment, having auditory impairment, having orthopedic impairment, then mental impairment, and certain person who have better mental capability as compared to other children. These are few divisions of exceptional children.
Okay. So suppose you find a autistic child, okay, child is suffering from autism. So as an administrator, do you know of any schemes that the government has to take care of the development, the studies of those special children?
Sir, I know, but not able to recall now.
Okay, fine. So in the family life cycle, how many stages are there?
Sir, basically 3 stages.
What are they?
early stage, expanding stage, and declining or finished declining stage.
Okay, so you know, like in which stage the couple has maximum time and which stage the couple has minimum time?
So minimum time in the expanding stage, because they have given birth to their child, they will take care of their child, they will engage themselves in the schooling, take care of their studies. So this is the period where the parents have the minimal time. And they have more time during the early stage because they are only 2% and no other person. They are engaged in their own discussion, better how to better be acquainted with each other. They don't have any more person in their family. And in the later period also, like the ending period also, they have much time because their parents, all their children are now employed. They basically doesn't stay with them. So yes sir, in the early period as well as later and declining period, they have more time as compared to the expanding phase of their life cycle.
Okay. So, you know, what are the main things which you have to remember during money management?
Money management?
Of a family. Money management. Making a budget for a family. What are the steps that you will take?
So basically money management deals with two things mainly, that is expenditure of the family and income of the family. So we have to tick all the expenditure of the family and tick all the incomes of the family, like the two to four members in the family, two parents, both are earning parents and the children don't have their income. So we have to take care what are the incomes of the parents. And while spending, we have to tick all the boxes like what are the requirements, the housing, the clothing, the miscellaneous expenses, the laundry expenses, the fooding expenses. All this should be taken care of and a proper budget should be prepared so that their expenditure is minimal or less than their income.
Tell me, what is the main reason, okay, that in your living room, okay, there should be ample sunlight in the living room, in the living room, not the bedroom, the common living space, okay, what we call as the dining table and all those things where people meet for lunch and all. Okay. Why sunlight is more required and how will you design the house during the site and the plan layout so that you will get maximum sunlight in that area? And apart from that area, in which other areas you require maximum sunlight? In which other rooms?
Sir, maximum sunlight is required in the kitchen area and the living area. In living area, light is required because living area is the room where in the middle class, the children of the family basically perform their study, and so they can use the daylight time. And the living room is the room in which all the guests of the family comes, so they can enjoy their meal and better gatherings in the sunlight. And kitchen is another area which requires sufficient amount of sunlight. Sir, so yes, sir.
That is what you have prepared. Yes. Okay. You know about polyester? Tell me something about the physical and chemical properties of polyester.
Sir, I have not read textiles.
Textiles you have not read. Okay. Dyeing and printing?
Left that part. Okay.
So, tell me, what are the steps, okay, in the home science extension process? How home science extension is basically, what is the concept of home science extension, why it is important?
Sir, home science extension is an informal education which is provided to the rural people to increase their knowledge, attitude and skills towards various areas. Basically, this is done to provide them education, to to deal with various problems which the people of the rural, which the rural people are facing themselves. And extension education extension process has basically five steps. First is analysis of the facts. Second is situation and what are the problems they are facing. Third is the object or solution of this problem. Fourth is the teaching plan of action. And last is the evaluation. These are the various steps of an extension process. First, we have to analyze what are the problem being main problem being faced by the rural people, and we should prioritize their requirement. Second is we should know what are the solution and which will be the optimal solution for the problem they faced. Then third is the teaching plan of action. That is, it is basically the execution steps, how to deal with the problems they are suffering, which will be the best solution. And fourth is the evaluation stage. In this evaluation stage, we will see that whether all the up to what amount we have reached our goal, and whether all the goals that we have ticked are been fulfilled. So sir, basically these are the five stages of extension process.
So as a administrative officer, how will you make how will you basically use extension education for your advantage? Home science extension.
Sir, basically as an administrator, I can deal with the rural peoples through my home science experience, like providing the women's various type of employment schemes, like enabling them to prepare pickles, various type of papads, which they will be not able to without the extension study. Secondly, sir, malnutrition is the one of the most important factors. I could use my extension knowledge and aware them about the nutrition problem. Then, sir, I could enhance the performance of the rural youth through providing them awareness about the various ill effects of alcohol, cigarettes, etc. Then I can help the rural development through construction of infrastructure, providing them with better facilities like clubhouse, rural infrastructure, development of rural primary schooling. So yes sir, I can use extension service to develop all these areas which are quite vital areas in the development of rural place.
Okay, so that will be the end of the interview. Thank you.